to the first in a series of Pali classes. So we'll be going through the Pali Primer by Lily De Silva. And the plan is to get through the whole book by mid-December. And at that point, if there's still interest, we'll start another series using a more difficult book. So the Pali Primer is a relatively gentle, slow-paced introduction, which is why we're going to fly through it pretty quickly, hopefully. So I had requested that people study the first three chapters before coming here. Did anyone actually read the first three chapters? Yes. No.
Skimmed it. I was studying it, but. Yeah.
Okay. Well, we'll start with
maybe.
We'll start with skimming. And you had some prior studies,
yeah.
So you'll probably be okay. So the first three chapters covers only a handful of grammatical cases. So the three different noun cases, the nominative, accusative, and instrumental cases, and only one set of verb tenses. So just to talk a bit about the different cases that are used for nouns in Pali. So the nominative is a noun that is the main actor in the sentence. So for example, when you say, the cat sniffs my keyboard, cat is the nominative noun. The accusative is the object that something is happening to. So in the cat sniffs my keyboard, keyboard is the accusative. It's the object of action. So accusative, like when you accuse someone, then someone is in the accusative case. It's the object of action. Instrumental is the instrument by which something is done. So, for example, the cat sniffs using his nose. So using his nose, that phrase is instrumental. In Pali, uses his nose would be a single word. So using the nose would be a single word, nasena, using the nose. And with each one of these, the Pali Primer gives us the both singular and plural forms. And this is all, I should also clarify, only for nouns that end in A. So if you've looked at the vocabulary lists, did anyone memorize the vocabulary for these three chapters?
No.
Anyone? Okay. Next time, try to memorize some stuff. It'll help a lot. So, for example, Buddha. Buddha is a Pali noun that ends in A. Or Manusa, a Pali noun that ends in A. And those are by far the most common, which is why that's what we're starting with. They're by far the most common, and they also have a very simple, straightforward declension system. So Pali is extremely light on prepositions or other helper words to indicate what's happening with the words in the sentence. So as mentioned, for example, in Pali we would say using the nose, three distinct words, and that's what we'd say in English. In Pali we would just say nasena, so a single word that means using the nose. So rather than use extra words to indicate the role that a particular word has in the sentence, we just change the ending of the word. So taking the example of, Manusa. So Manusa means human. So singular, human, Manuso. Multiple humans, Manusa. Something happening to a single human, Manusang. Something happening to multiple humans, manusse. Something happening using or with a single human, manusena. Something happening with multiple humans, manusehi. Any questions so far? Yes.
So, because I've looked this up before, this is just with a, right? Not with the long a.
It's a different, rather than a.
Okay, so a.
If you have not studied the Pali pronunciation guide, I recommend looking at it closely.
Yeah.
The one in the Pali Primer is a fairly simple pronunciation guide. The only thing that it doesn't explain clearly is the retroflex or cerebral consonants, the consonants with a dot under them. Everything else is explained quite well in Polyprimer. The best pronunciation guide I've seen is in A.K. Warder's Introduction to Poly, which at some point we will study, but that's an advanced text, so we won't get to it anytime soon. Yeah.
So then would the Buddha be plural and Buddha singular?
So yes, Buddha singular, Buddha plural.
Okay.
So
what is Buddha?
That is the non-declined form, the stem form of the word. So Buddha is undeclined, the stem form of the noun. And you will very rarely see the stem form used in an actual text, because you always see nouns declined. You never see them without declination, without declension. The one exception is that sometimes the vocative form of a noun is the same as the stem form. So if you're speaking directly to someone, then that's the vocative form. And we'll get to vocative later, so I don't want to talk about it right now. For now, suffice to say that you generally do not see the stem form of a word. You only see it declined. So you don't see Buddha in the text. You see Buddho, Buddha, Buddhang, Buddhe, Buddhena, Buddhehi, and so on. So we're just starting with a handful of cases so that it's not overwhelming. Is this overwhelming? You hesitated. Is it overwhelming?
No,
okay.
I'm absorbing it.
That's fine. Are we okay with nouns, or do we need further explanation here? All right, so verbs. Similarly, verbs are declined, and there's several different conjugations of verbs that are used, but fortunately, they all follow a very distinct pattern. So it's verbs are much less complex to understand than nouns. So verbs that end with T are singular, present tense.
Mm-hmm.
Verbs that end with NT are plural, present tense.
Mm-hmm.
So this is all present tense. So like bahasati, speaks. So manuso bahasati, the human speaks, present tense. Manusa bahasanti, humans speak. So the singular verb will always match a singular nominative noun. Plural verb will always match a plural nominative noun. So this is one thing that you can use as a guide when you're reading a sentence. If you're not quite sure what's going on, if you can identify whether the verb is singular or plural, then you'll know whether or not the nominative noun should be singular or plural. And vice versa, if you're confident that which noun is the nominative noun, then you'll be able to identify the corresponding verb tense as well. Everyone with me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so at this point, I'd like to go through some exercises using some, again, hopefully people would have some vocabulary, so this will be slightly choppier going through this, because I'm not going to move forward with anything until somebody gives me the correct answer. So we have a few examples that I came up with. So if you've gone through the exercises in the book, these are not the exercises from the book. So what I would like is, we're going to go through this, and I would like people to tell me what these sentences are saying. If you have to cheat and look up the vocab in your book, that's okay. I don't mind. As long as somebody is able to give me the correct answer. So this runs roughly in accordance with the three chapters. So we're starting with chapter one. Naro sayati. Anybody have any clue what this is saying?
Person sleeps.
Close. Naro is specifically man.
Man? Oh,
yeah.
Right,
so so nara is man in specific.
Mm-hmm.
Purisa is used more generally to mean person. Though purisa sometimes also specifically means man. But generally speaking, nara is clearly man. Purisa has a broader meaning of person.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Naro sayati, correct. Kasaka Kasanti.
Farmer cow.
Close.
Farmer's cow.
Yes. So note kasa ka. So we have the plural ending on the noun. And kasanti. Kasanti, the plural ending on the verb as well. Another little feature here that I'd like to point out, which is not in the lesson here, and I don't think is anywhere in this book, but you'll notice kasaka, kasanti, farmer's plow. You might notice that there's a similarity between the noun, the root of the noun, farmer, and the root of the verb, plowing. So in fact, more literal than farmer would probably be a plower or plowman, plows. So this is another feature which, as you start to accumulate vocabulary, you'll naturally get a sense for the roots of words. And you'll notice, you'll be able to draw these immediate similarities. So that eventually you'll see a word that you've never encountered before, and you'll be able to tell what it means, just based on its similarity to other words that you know. Minor fun side point. Feel free to ask questions at any point during this, or if I'm going too fast, let me know. If I'm going too slow, let me know. You have a question?
Yes. So, for things like naro sayati,
sayati,
so do we just say man sleeps, or a man sleeps, or the man sleeps?
Pali rarely includes articles. So words like the, a, or an are not found in Pali. On the rare occasions where such things are used, they use pronouns. So for example, the pronoun he, so, you might see so naro sayati. And in that case, so is a stand-in for how we would use the article the. But generally speaking, you won't see that. You would just see naro sayati, and when translating that, you would have to include articles. So when translating from Pali to English, you'll almost always wind up with a lot more words in the English translation, because Pali is an extremely sparse and dense language. There's a lot of meaning packed into a very small amount of space. Okay? Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
And then pronunciation, so is that accent always on the last syllable unless there's an accent over the letter? Like narrow?
So the Pali alphabet has, I believe, 42 letters, 41 letters, sorry, 41 letters. The English alphabet has only 26. So in order to create the extra letters that are needed, there's a system of accent marks, of lines and dots. So those are actually different letters.
Mm-hmm.
The accent, we just don't really use the word accent in Pali, let me think about it. Rather, it's just
stress.
The stress.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, that's what I meant. The stress.
Stress.
The emphasis. Yeah.
They don't really talk about emphasis either. What it rather is timing. And that would be a whole class just on Pali pronunciation. But briefly speaking, a vowel that does not have a line over it and is followed by either a single consonant or no consonants will be quick. It'll have half time. The one exception to that is a vowel followed by the nasal consonant, the M with a dot. This is pronounced full time.
Okay.
So, navo sayati. Kasaka kasanti kumara dhavanti yachako patang harati.
Okay.
You see how that works?
Yeah, kind of. It's not like Spanish where it's always
the penultimate.
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
And so
it depends on what other consonants are around it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so the timing of Pali can sound a bit awkward if you're not used to it, because it seems totally random. The only difference, the only place it doesn't seem random is in Pali poetry, where they intentionally select long and short syllables to make it rhythmic.
Mm-hmm.
So you'll notice that in some of the suttas, the ones that are in verse, they have a distinct rhythm. But that's the only place you'll find it.
Okay.
Whenever Pali is written in prose, it sounds very random and disjointed in terms of timing. Unless you're familiar with Pali, then it just sounds like Pali.
Okay.
So, continuing with this, Kumara Davanti.
The boys run away? Are they fleet?
The boys run.
They run,
yeah.
Okay.
Yachako Patang Hareti. We're getting a little more complicated now. Yachako Patam Harati. What's that?
Isn't Harati eat or
no? No. Yachako Patam Harati.
The beggar takes the bowl.
Correct.
Right.
Yes. Yachako, beggar, patam, bowl, harati.
Takes.
Takes. Correct. Okay. Manusa gamang gachanti.
The men come to the village.
Close.
Oh, leave.
Still not quite.
Go.
Yes.
Go to?
Go to the village.
Go to the
correct.
Village.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah. We don't yet have the tense for from. We'll get that in a later chapter.
Hmm.
So, manusa, the humans, plural, gachanti, go, gamang, to the village. So this is also a time when I should point out that in Pali sentences, word order is mostly irrelevant.
Hmm.
So in English, word order makes a tremendous difference. In Pali, it rarely makes much difference. So you could take these three words and put them in any order you want, and the sentence would mean exactly the same thing. That said, generally speaking, the format that you see is nominative, accusative, verb.
Mm-hmm.
So, actor, object, action.
Subject, object, verb.
Yeah, subject, object, verb. Thank you. I don't actually know English grammatical terms. I only know Pali grammatical terms. So, bear with me. I briefly considered learning English grammatical terms so that I could explain Pali, but it seems like too much work.
Nobody knows the English grammatical
exactly.
terms.
Exactly! Then I would have to explain both the Pali terms and the English terms.
Don't do it,
I only know the English ones because French uses the same.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, moving along. Bhupalo Vanije Rakati. Good, the king.
Protect.
Oh.
Good, the king protects
merchant.
The merchants. Merchants, plural.
Plural.
Yeah, plural.
Okay.
Vanijay, plural.
Yeah.
Excellent. Brahmana Suryang Pasanti.
The Brahmins see the sun.
Correct. Great. Samana Dhammang Pasanti.
The Samanas speak the Dhamma.
So what's a samana?
Samana are
monks.
They go forth.
Monks.
Actually, yeah, monk is one translation.
The shramans, they're like
yeah.
Bhikkhus.
I like to translate samana as contemplative personally.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember how it's translated in here. I think it is translated monk.
Recluse.
That is an awful translation.
Not judging her.
There's two possible etymologies for the word samana. One is from the word peace, and the other is from the word weary.
Mm-hmm.
So samana can either mean the peace seeker or the world weary one.
Mm-hmm.
So either one is etymologically accurate. But its effective meaning is a religious renunciate. A contemplative, someone who's committed their life to spiritual practice. Samana dhammang pasanti, so the contemplatives teach Dhamma, and what is Dhamma?
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 Yeah, the samanas pasanti, the Dhamma.
There you go.
What is Dhamma? This is not a trick question.
the way things
doctrine.
Are.
The doctrine.
Okay. Correct. Correct. What did you say?
Doctrine.
Doctrine?
Yeah.
Yeah. So Dhamma means the way things are. It means a body of teachings. It means doctrine. It means can also specifically mean the Buddhist teachings. Dhamma can also mean thing or object.
Mm-hmm.
So that's not included in this lesson, but it's important to know later on. Dhamma has a very broad sense, actually. It can mean any object is a Dhamma. But most commonly, the word Dhamma means a teaching. Bhupalo ratena pabhatang gacchati. Now we're getting a little more complicated. Not you, somebody else.
That's
I'm
right.
Glad that you know some Pali already. But let's see if some other people come in some Pali.
Can I look at my notes?
You can just move the cat off of your notebook.
How does one move a cat
there.
Safely?
With your hands.
Okay.
And loving kindness. We got that part.
Yeah.
So, Bhupalo ratena pambatang gacchati. We already know at least
king.
Two of these words.
Okay.
The king, good.
Goes to.
Good. Gacchati.
Was a vehicle?
Yes, using a vehicle. Ratta means cart or chariot.
Oh, to the mountain.
To the mountain. Pavatang, to the mountain. Correct. So putting it all together.
A king goes to the mountain using a vehicle?
Correct.
Using a chariot?
Good. Excellent. Okay. Pandita sadhing savakehi sagang gacchanti. Don't be scared.
Wise men.
Wise men? Good. Pandita?
Go to.
Yeah, they go. Okay. Michael, you're welcome to speak if you know things.
No, this one, Bhante, of course, I wouldn't know as well.
Okay.
Savakehi, is that, it's not Savaka. Savaka
it is?
Sangpo, it's this, is that what they call Savaka? Okay. Savaka Sangpo. What is Savaka?
Come on. Look it up in your books if you have to.
Disciple, yeah, disciple, Savaka Sangpo.
So, sorry?
Heaven,
yes. Sagang is heaven. So the wise men go to heaven. Savakehi.
As the disciples, with the disciples.
With the disciples, correct.
The
how about sadding? What's this word doing here?
Sadding.
What's that?
It's was.
With?
Yeah, isn't that was?
Yes, it's with. So the word sadding, you will sometimes see used in conjunction with an instrumental word, but not always. Sometimes it's present and sometimes it's not. When it is present, it's usually with people rather than with objects. So you would never see, generally speaking, you wouldn't see Bhupalo Sadding Ratena. But you would see Panita Sadding Savakehi. So the wise men with the disciples. So sadding means like together or along or in conjunction.
So it's like the Spanish for the person.
Yeah. So
in I guess this is also like a word order thing. In this they put the sadding sadding, how do you pronounce the
sadding?
Sadding. After the ahi.
I'm not actually sure why they did that, because in the suttas you'll almost always see it before. So I'm not sure why they put it after in the lesson book.
Okay.
But it doesn't matter whether it's before or after, because it doesn't actually matter whether sadding is there or not. It's in, I mention it here because you'll see it, and it's mentioned in the book. But in terms of actual sentence construction, it doesn't really mean anything. It's more included for emphasis.
Mm. And is there a difference between sadding and saha?
Not really, though practically speaking, saha seems to be more general in its usage, and that you'll see saha used to refer to objects,
mm-hmm.
whereas sadding is usually used to refer to people.
Mm.
But otherwise, they have basically the same meaning, with or together with or along with.
Why is the disciples in the instrumental piece?
Because he's going with his disciples. So instrumental means with, by, through, or using.
Like,
so
when you see, when you say with, it can mean literally like with,
like
with my cat, I went to the store.
Yeah, like come with me to the restaurant.
Huh.
We would use the instrumental. So like Sudaso Sanena. So Sudaso with Sunny.
Huh?
Oh. Glad to have you with us.
Thank you. I'm so glad to be here. Sorry, I was kidding.
No worries. did you read the lessons beforehand?
I didn't see the name of that.
I
didn't
know. But you know
okay.
What I did? I know that it was said primer, so I did really copied something. I don't know if this is from the way we are.
Lily De Silva?
Yes.
Great, you've got the right thing.
Okay.
Did you read it beforehand at all?
Yeah.
Okay, next time.
Yes.
So try to follow along as best you can this time, and then read the material for next time.
That started with lesson one?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, at the end of this class, I'll give the readings for next time.
Okay.
So you'll just have double homework.
Okay.
It's not hard. I mean, we're only doing a couple pages at a time. So, Panitasa Ding Savakehi Sagang Gachanti. What did this mean again?
The wise one go with their disciples to heaven.
Great. Yeah, so the wise men with their disciples go to heaven. Mitta magena viharam gachati. Somebody else. No offense.
It's completely okay.
I'm really happy that you know this stuff, though.
A friend.
Mitta.
Oh, right. Okay. Friends?
Friends, correct, plural. Friends.
Go
to the monastery.
Go
to the monastery.
Vihara,
yeah.
To the monastery.
Okay.
Vihara literally means a dwelling, but it usually has the specific meaning of a monastic dwelling, a place where monks or nuns live. So, mitta, friends, gachati, go, viharam, to the monastery.
Using the path?
Yes, or along the road. Using the road. Yeah. Great. Yachaka saha sahayakehi pavitam aruhati. At least two of these words we already know.
Wait, I have a question for
uh-huh.
The gachati part.
Yeah, gachati.
Yeah, isn't that the singular?
Oh, it should be gachati.
Excellent. See, I'm going to pretend that I included an error just to see who would catch it. So, congratulations. Maybe on each class I'll include one intentional error and see who catches it. We'll see. Is that diabolical?
No. then it should be Aruhanti as well.
Oi. I blame the cat. He's biting. So yachaka saha sahayakehi pavitam aruhanti.
The beggars.
Good. Beggars, yachaka.
With friends.
Climb mountains.
Saha sahayakehi with friends. Aruhanti, climb
mountains.
Singular. Singular. Pavitam is singular.
Pavitam.
So the M with a dot is pronounced like So pub and tongue. Yes.
I've only seen it underneath.
You
the same?
Will also see the dot underneath, and that's the same. In the
okay.
case of M, you'll see it either above or below.
Okay.
Either way, it's okay.
Wait,
and
what?
In some older texts, you'll also see this
yeah.
peculiar thing.
Yeah.
So, those are three ways of writing the same thing, which all sound like NG. Exactly so. So, Yashikasaha Sahayukehi Pavatang Aruhanti. And I intentionally put Saha and Sahayukehi together because Saha means with or together with. So a sahaya or sahayaka is someone who goes with you. It's
mm-hmm.
a companion. So in the lesson book it's translated as friend, which is technically okay, but companion is more literal. And companion very clearly points this out. So saha with sahayakehi, with companions. Okay, are we good so far?
Mm-hmm.
Savaka Buddhang Vandanti. Really easy one.
Mm-hmm.
You're not allowed to answer. Super easy.
The disciples worship.
Worship.
The Buddha.
Yay! Okay, well, how did that feel?
It's good.
Good.
Okay. Do you have any questions from online?
No.
Okay, in that case, we can shut off the recording.
Okay.